Yeah, I saw the documentary, Frontline documentary on Jeff Bezos, and I'm taking a different position than I would as a liberal on any large company, and that is I think Jeff's doing it right. I see a lot of parallels between things Christ said and Christ did, and what Bezos is doing is, he's taking that line, but he's doing it in an odd way that people don't see as being productive. What he's doing is he's trying to satisfy everybody's needs, and the mantra there is that the customer comes first. That's everybody's mantra, but he's looking for innovative ways of solving problems. And I think that's very important, especially in a world where it doesn't seem like we're doing enough innovation, where companies will do a lot of research and then they will hold on, they'll put that into a safe, and then they'll look at the market and they'll see if it really needs, if innovation really needs to be there. If their competitors challenge them, then they bring stuff out of the safe and they use that to fight back, but they're really not trying to go anywhere with it. They're just trying to make as much money as they can possibly make, but where is it going to go? And the difference is if you look at anybody else in the marketplace, where are they going? What is their vision? What is their dream? Where are they going to? You look at Bezos, he's going to space. So he's inspiring everybody else. Where, if you look at Walmart, where are they going? They're just making more money. If you go and you look at Tesla, where he going? He is actually inspiring people. So they're picking on these little guys like Bezos and Elon Musk, and they are little guys, even though Bezos has got like $1 trillion and is like the first trillionaire. The thing is that he's shooting for the moon and nobody else is. And I think that's good. He's said something at the very last of that documentary, and that was he said big things start small, big businesses start smaller. So what he's really doing is he's paraphrasing to a little bit of a degree what Jesus said about if you have a mustard seed of faith, you can move mountains, which is basically what he's saying. And so I'm finding parallels in everything that he's doing to things that Christ would push about. And even though he's not unionized, he is requiring of his business to pay people twice what the minimum wage is, which is beyond the living wage. It's minimum wage is like $7 an hour in Texas. So I would assume that he's paying his employees $14 or $15 an hour. And living wage in Texas, where I'm at, is $12 an hour. There is a website called livingwage.mit.edu. If you go up to it and you put in your state, it will tell you what the minimum wage is supposed to be, and I mean what the living wage is supposed to be, and it'll tell you what living wage is, and it'll tell you what the poverty wage is, which is like the lowest that anybody's ever like been making and just getting by with, but not really surviving very well. So that's probably poverty wage is like $5 an hour. So that's probably what Mexican illegal Mexicans that are working in Texas are probably making $5 an hour. That's poverty wage, and that's that you just can't put up with that. Minimum wage forces workers to work twice as long. I work as a bagger, but I really don't depend on this job. I use my position mainly to try to find of creative ways of innovating the store chain that I'm working for by starting by not being at the top, but being at the bottom. by trying to change the way people see themselves and say and change the way the customers see me and others, that we all are people and we all have character and we have unique abilities. And I've said at times that I think I'm in hell, but it also could be heaven. I don't know. And I'm not going to try to put a label on it and say it's this one or this way. I'm someone who's trying to push an agenda, and I'm saying that I'm going to do it my way, and I'm creative. I'll just probably be creative to the end, and we'll see what happens at the very end of it all. But I see that maybe if I've got really bad morals, then I'll see that I just made the bad decision at the very end of it. But I mean, things could shake up in ways that don't make any sense. Things could go good, things could go bad. When I see somebody who's trying to do something important or seems like they're doing something, if I could be lied to by the media, I could be lied to by anybody, but when I'm not really doing some of the things I'm saying, which is looking at lots of different news sources, but the thing I see with Amazon and this is mainly is that the people that are working in Amazon and they go there expecting to find a lifelong position at Amazon. What Amazon's saying is that we're really looking to hire young people who will work for a short amount of time. You're not going to have your life position here. You're going to work for a short amount of time in a very competitive environment that is working super efficiently. And the young people are kind of the oil that are going to keep this thing lubricated. And what Amazon's doing on their end is they're trying to make it better how this machine works. And the older people that come into Amazon, they are competing with younger tykes. And it's going to be very difficult for them to have the lifestyle they had when they were young at Amazon, because unless they had developed in such a way that they could get into a position elsewhere in the Amazon chain, like working in data services or things like that. At the store I work at, I can see that they make a lot of more missteps than Amazon does. And it's my hope that in the future, if Amazon, if my store, and I won't say their name because they put in their regulations that you can't involve them in social discussion, but I mean, people can look me up and they can figure out who I work for. I would hope that Amazon gets to the point to where they are at something like 300 GDP billion D GDP. Walmart's at like 550 billion GDP. The one I work for is at 110 GDP. And the one I work for, it seems like they're more efficient, but they cut corners. From my experience as working there, they cut corners at every little step. And I can talk at very minute details. And I would probably only talk about it if they fired me, then I would release more information about what it is that I think about their how they work things at the low level. The thing is, my major problem that I have with the employer that I work with is that the policy they push down, they're not subject to. It's one of my major problems is that people at the top will push. And everybody does this in the country. And you know, you sit at the top, you have the alpha males enjoy the all of the flexibility they have, but the people that work for them have no flexibility. They have no room to breathe. They don't have the ability to be creative, to actually improve their, to actually love their job, and to improve how they present solutions to people. The way the people that I work with work is they're in fear of losing their job. And because they're in fear of losing their job, they push the policy that gets thrown down to them, but they don't have any room to be creative, to actually be a better person, or to actually push their character. They don't, there's not much of themselves in it. And the company would push that this is all a tight-knit family and all this stuff. But the truth of the matter is they don't ha it's like a car that's driving with no oil in it. It is the friction inside of the car is going to destroy the engine, and at some point it's going to break down. And if I look at Amazon, they don't really have this problem. They know exactly who they're hiring, what where they're going, why they're doing certain things. They're not unionized, but they're not Walmart. They're not like Walmart. They're not unionized. Better than Walmart, they're actually offering a better pay to younger people. They're encouraging them to go to school, to get degrees, to go and form businesses and do things that are greater, and possibly come back and become part of the ranks of Amazon itself. Amazon is a tech company. It is not really a retail giant. It's a tech company. And because it's a tech company, they have brains in there, and they're not like a brick and mortar. This was a thing that we really pushed for in the dot-com era, was that everybody thought that with the dot-coms that anybody could become a brick and mortar. And what failed in the dot-coms is that it wasn't that easy. And Amazon has been more successful at it because they had a long-term goal. They weren't in it for short-term success like a lot of the dot-coms were. People were so focused on getting a lot of angel investment than turning around and making lots of money by being like really as big as Amazon, which was not going to happen. What Amazon did is they told people that we're not going to be profitable. It's going to take years. This is going to be innovative. That it's going to be about trying to create an environment, a venue that through which people can do business online. And if you look at the way websites are, people don't gravitate to websites unless they have something to offer that no other website offers. And that's my website is kind of a mashup. It really doesn't offer anything more than what YouTube is. My website is, I made it for me. It's a lifestyle. If it was a lifestyle business, it would be a lifestyle business, but I don't even consider it a business. I just consider it a different way of looking at solving a problem. And that's, I would rather be somebody who's got enough money to live by. I don't really care about being rich. I don't really care about controlling the world from high up. I would rather change the culture. That's always been the thing that I strive to do, is kind of change the culture, change the way people feel in a culture, change the way people think about things, change try to make people a little more creative, try to show people that they do have talents, but the talents don't have to be used to make money, that they could be used just to make themselves happier. I sing in the parking lot when I'm at work, and the only reason why I do that, people say, "Well, you're happy and you're singing." I say, "No, I sing to be happy, because when I'm down, I'll start a song and it usually makes me feel better. That's the reason why I sing." And people say, "I love your voice." And usually the only time I use the scene is when I'm in front of customers, is when I feel like a customer is starting to water down what I'm doing at the end. And if I get a customer who's does something like they will like sit there and tell me, oh, I need these all in the cold bag. I need this. I need this. And they think that I'm like retarded. And I hate to say it, but this is what the grocery store chains do, is they prey upon paying people minimum wage, while at the same time, this is saying that we're interested in 16-year-olds, 17-year-olds, who are not going to stay around long enough to really be in this job for more than 6 months. We're interested in people who are mentally handicapped or handicapped in some way. We're not interested in a real bagger who is trying to do something creative and innovative and trying to open up a view that we are the last, we are the non-existent, what do you call it, the quality assurance team, okay? They always put in our policy and say that we're the last people the customer sees. The customer's perception of the store is us, but they don't treat us like that. And so they themselves don't have enough vision on what we are, okay? Then someone like I, and I might be able to bring something more to it. I'm a bit more intellectual than the normal person who is at the end of the table of the guy who's bagging, as being somebody who's unimportant or invisible or working at minimum wage, who's in fear of their job. And I'm presenting the complete opposite, and the reason why I'm doing that is to try to make people become aware that their perception, their judgment, their prejudice is making them complacent. I'm trying to ruin complacency. I'm trying to make people to get out of the complacency of because complacency, and I've spent a lot of life in complacency. I know that complacency can be bad, because it can make you like fail to like actually do something important. And I probably avoided making some really good choices and changing how things are done, but I'm doing it late in the game, and maybe I still can do something. But I'm really just, all I'm saying is I'm saying that there's room for creativity. We need more lubrication in these machines that are running, that are permitting people to survive. These machines need more lubrication. They can't run on almost no lubrication. You can't cut corners. Cutting corners just makes people into less than machines. And that's what a lot of people are saying about Amazon, but I'm just saying that's going to be true for Amazon because of the kind of business that they're running, and they're not saying that people are disposable. I don't think that's the case. I think it's more like the Olympics, is that people that are really trying hard will go far. But they are going to be more attractive to young people who are willing to work long hours, just like that song from Styx about the blue collar man. You know, I'm willing to keeping my eye on through the keyhole. You know, I'll do whatever it takes. I long to be a blue collar man, and so I think that's exactly what Amazon's doing, is they're focusing on one area, and they're focusing on a method, and they're trying to go in that direction. It's the rest of the business world is realizing that they're going to drain the swamp, in a sense. They do have lobbyists in the government, but it sounds like the lobbyism that they're doing is more is probably helping than hurting. I personally believe that we should not permit anybody in Congress to ever become lobbyists for 5 years. And that's because it gives people in Congress an unfair advantage when they have direct ties to people they know in the government that could help them leverage, help a company leverage their weight inside the government. And that's going to be necessary for draining the swamp. I got that from, trying to remember his name. But anyhow, the thing is that I'm of two minds about Jeff Bezos and Amazon, but I can see a lot of parallels in there, that they're doing good things. And the bottom line is that it says in Christian rhetoric that that if a person's fruits are good, then the person must be good. Overall, I see Amazon as pretty good for me as a customer, and their vision is to keep the customer satisfied. It's kind of hard if it's kind of hard to say that they're doing the wrong thing, because they're not, even though they're working their employees really hard, they're trying to make it easier for their employees. They're trying to do things safely. They're trying to pay people good wages that are above minimum wage, twice minimum wage. They're doing it. They're doing it the right way, is what I'm thinking. And so it's the way that I would want it to be done, and it's probably, they're doing it the only way that probably can be done, that we probably won't be able to do it in the government because of the way that our country is working. So maybe Amazon tries through their lobbyism to actually write themselves out of the lobbyism business by maybe pushing Jeff Bezos into the presidency, which is maybe Jeff might do, I don't know. But the thing is that I think it's, he's doing it right, and I don't really have much problem with that stuff, until I see that he's like using that he has factories in China or somewhere where he's abusing the rights of people over there and paying them dirt wages, and then increasing his profit by multiplying the what he paid them for, lowering their cost and increasing his price, which is what Walmart does. It doesn't seem that Amazon actually does that they actually reduce the cost, or that they increase people, the cost of the people that they're hiring. They don't do it at the cost of the person. Until somebody can show me in a large part that they're offloading their costs, that they're doing negative externalities, they're offloading the cost of their processes onto the little guys, in order to increase their margins, then I probably won't see it as a bad business, because that's what Walmart does. And there's a documentary, a whole documentary about that. And I have yet to see like any. The only people that seem to really hate Amazon are in where I work, are a lot of rich people. And you talk about Amazon, there's some people that will get really infuriated, and I'm like, these are the people that need to be infuriated, not the poor people. And if you are young and you're trying to get ahead in the world and you need something more than minimum wage, you can either work two jobs or you can work at Amazon. And if you're working at Amazon for 40 hours, or you're working at two jobs for 80 hours, you're getting paid the same amount of wage. Which one's worse? And so what that means is that the young people are going to go to Amazon because they work less time. The older people are going to go and work at minimum wage jobs because those jobs, those companies can't demand a whole lot from them. And maybe I'm working at the wrong place, but what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to present a perspective that you can't do negative externalities, and I'm actually permitting the people that I'm working for to do some negative externality things through me. All I'm just doing is, and they're not doing it directly, they're not expecting it of me, I'm just doing it. And what I'm doing is I'm proving to them that they don't treat their own people well. And I'm proving to them that it could improve their business if they treated their people well, if they had enough creativity, if they were innovative, if they could go out on a limb to do something rather than being super complacent and conservative. And because the worst part of conservatism is complacency. That is not wanting to move. That's what is said in the Bible, that you're storing up things in a barn and you'll be dead tomorrow and it won't mean anything, okay? You're not using your talents to do something. You know, you're not using your talent. And my talent, I believe, is philosophy. It's just, I could go and develop technology, I could develop software, but I'm not really good at that. I'm not really good at doing 3D computer animation. I'm good at collecting information and seeing things. I'm kind of a visionary, but I kind of see things, I see the future, and then I just spout it out on YouTube, and I don't expect anything back from it. I don't care. All I care about is being inspired and living day to day and trying to be positive, even though, you know, I have failures and I've put them out there, and I'm just saying that, you know, these failures are not going to affect me. I'm not going to let it affect me. And I mean, if this is hell, I would say to God, you know, why throw the baby out with the bathwater is my take on things. So I'm just, and I think that's the case. I think he's perfectly okay with what I'm doing. So.